Good morning, and thank you for worshiping with us at the Church of St. Augustine and St. Martin, in person and virtually, via Zoom and YouTube. If you are remote, to follow along, the worship book and readings can be downloaded from our website. For those joining via Zoom, we invite you to keep yourself on mute until the time of the peace, when you will be invited to greet each other. If you are reading a lesson or prayers of the people, please remember to unmute yourself before you speak. Use the chat box if you have any questions or need help, and to share birthdays, anniversaries, and any other prayer needs. Wherever you are, we invite you to pray out loud to give thanks to God, so that all of our voices from different locations may rise up to God as one congregation. Again, thank you for joining us, and we will continue with the prelude.
To our God.
I want everybody all over the world to sing hallelujah.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent for the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
God, open our lips,
and our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
Praise to the holy and undivided Trinity, one God, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Alleluia. The psalm appointed for today doesn't need to be. The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 77, verses 1 through 2 and 11 through 20. The congregation will read the part following the asterisk. I will cry aloud to God.
I will cry aloud and he will hear me.
It's in the bulletin, sorry. So the second page of the bulletin, Psalm 77. I will cry aloud to God.
I will cry aloud and he will hear me.
In the day of my trouble, I sought the Lord.
My hands were stretched out by night and did not tire. I refused to be comforted.
I will remember the works of the Lord.
And call to mind your wonders of tongue.
I will meditate on all your acts.
And ponder your mighty deeds.
Your way, O God, is holy.
Who is so great, God, as our God?
You are the God who works wonders.
And have declared your power among the peoples.
By your strength you have redeemed your people.
The children of Jacob and Joseph.
The waters saw you, O God, the waters saw you and trembled.
The very depths were shaken.
The clouds poured out water, the skies thundered.
Your arrows flashed to and fro.
The sound of your thunder was in the whirlwind. Your lightnings lit up the world.
The earth trembled and shook.
Your way was in the sea and your paths in the great waters.
Yet your footsteps were not seen.
You led your people like a flock.
By the hand of Moses and Aaron.
Praise to the holy and undivided Trinity, one God.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The first lesson.
A reading. Okay. Yes, a reading from 2 Kings. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were in their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elijah said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. Then Elijah said to Elisha, said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went. and stood at some distance from them. And as they both were standing by the Jordan, then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I'm taken from you." Elijah said, "Please let me inherit a double portion of the Spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken away from you, it will be granted you. For if not, it will not." And they continued walking and talking. A chariot of fire and horses of the fire separated the two of them. And Elijah ascended in the whirlwind to heaven. Elijah kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them into pieces. He picked up the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. He took the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and struck the water, saying, "Where is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" When he had struck the water was parted to the one side and to the other, and Elisha went over. The word of the Lord.
We'll read together the Song of Mary. We'll read it responsibly by the part leading up to the asterisk and the part following. My soul proclaims the greatness of God. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. This is found in the worship book on page 2. Sorry. All right, we'll start over. My soul proclaims the greatness of God. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. From this day, all generations will call me blessed. You have mercy on those who fear you. You have shown the strength of your arm. You have cast down the mighty from their thrones. You have filled the hungry with good things. You have come to the help of your servant Israel. The promise you made to our forebears. Praise to the holy and undivided Trinity, one God, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the first book of Kings. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Galatians. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit against a yoke of slavery, for you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters in Christ. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for your self-indulgence. But through love, become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in one single commandment: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you do not be consumed one another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit, the word of the Lord.
Please rise for the gospel as you are able. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. When the days drew near for Jesus to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he sent messengers ahead of him. On their way, they entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. But they did not receive him, because his face was set toward Jerusalem. When his disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them. Then they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." But Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home." Jesus said to him, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." The Gospel of Christ. Please be seated. I want to begin this morning by reading the statement from Bishop Gates and Bishop Harris on the Supreme Court Roe versus Wade reversal. The Supreme Court today issued a ruling effectively overturning the constitutional right to abortion that had been recognized in this country since 1973 in the case of Roe versus Wade. Your bishops stand with the long-held position of the Episcopal Church that equitable access to women's health care, including women's reproductive health care, is an integral part of a woman's struggle to assert her dignity and worth as a human being. Although abortion remains legal here in Massachusetts, and Governor Baker's executive order of today provides additional protections for reproductive health care providers serving out-of-state residents, we recognize that for many, the consequences of today's decision will be to codify unequal access to reproductive health care, exacting the heaviest burden on low-income communities and communities of color. Our church recognizes the complex, delicate, and deeply personal moral decision-making that surrounds the issue of abortion. In numerous articulations of its position, The Church has stated that we emphatically oppose abortion as a means of birth control, family planning, sex selection, or any reason of mere convenience. However, the Church has also declared its unequivocal opposition to any legislative, executive, or judicial action on the part of local, state, or national governance that abridges the right of a woman to reach an informed decision, or that would limit the access of a woman to safe means of acting on her decision. We affirm that, as is typical of an Anglican approach to ethical decision-making, our Church holds that governments must take special care to see that the individual conscience is respected and that the responsibility of individuals to reach informed decisions in this matter is acknowledged and honored as a position of this Church. We commend to you Presiding Bishop Michael Curry's statement to the Church today. With him, we urge Episcopalians to pray for all who will be harmed by this decision. We urge all, according to their own convictions, to support those organizations committed to just and equitable access to health care for all. And we urge Episcopalians to make their own voice heard according to the dictates of their own conscience, abiding in passion, compassion, and peace. And it was signed by the Right Reverend Alan M. Gates and the Right Reverend Gail E. Harris. You can find that statement on our website along with Bishop Curry's statement, Presiding Bishop Curry's statement. And now let us see how our lessons for today inform the work ahead. A prophet's work is never done. In today's reading from 2 Kings, we witness a transferal of power and ministry from Elijah to Elisha. Elijah could not go on forever, could not live forever, yet God's prophetic work needed to continue. Someone had to step up and claim Elijah's mantle. God had chosen Elisha to succeed Elijah, but what did that mean? Would God empower Elisha in the same way that Elijah had been empowered? Even if Elijah did not know the answer, it was for God to decide. If you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not. Elisha watched, and indeed he witnessed a chariot of fire carry Elijah into the sky and out of his sight. He took Elijah's mantle and did as Elijah had done. He struck the water with it and parted the water. A prophet's work is never done. This week's decision by the Supreme Court undid the work that so many had fought for and achieved, and raised fears that other rights that seem secure may also be revoked. The work of prophecy is work of justice. The charge of a prophet is to listen to God and to faithfully deliver God's words to those for whom they are meant. A prophet's work is to speak out against empire and culture that has turned from God's will, to call people to change, to align their wills and their action with God's. A prophet's work is by its nature prone to rejection. A prophet's work is often dangerous. A prophet's work is rooted in justice and love, God's love. God calls God's people to repentance in order that they may align themselves with the justice and love of God. Just as Elijah spoke the truth to power to the kings who had turned to idols and had used their power in pursuit of selfish goals, Moses also spoke the truth to Pharaoh that the subjugation of the Israelites to the Egyptians was unjust and against God's will. Moses did not choose this battle. God chose Moses to speak to Pharaoh. It makes sense. Moses had lived as a member of Pharaoh's household, as a prince of Egypt. Then his real origins were revealed to him, that he was the son of Hebrew slaves. He had the perspective of two opposing cultures. He could understand the reasoning of both, and with God's help, discern God's will, that the people of Israel were meant not for slavery, but for freedom. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Paul is speaking to the Christian community in Galatia. He is addressing division that has arisen within the churches that he himself had founded. There seem to have been two classes of Christians, Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians. The Jewish Christians were insisting that the Gentiles adopt their culture, specifically circumcision. They saw themselves as superior to their Gentile brothers and sisters, presumably because Jesus had been Jewish, and the Jews were the first to become his believers. Paul is of their culture, yet he argues against them. Paul speaks of being liberated from the traditions and beliefs that he had once defended because he finds their fulfillment in Christ. For freedom, Christ has set us free, yet Paul then tells them to become slaves to one another. Christians are bound together by love. They are not simply individuals free to do as they wish. Their actions must always take into account the well-being of each other. They must do everything within the framework of love. Paul is attempting to hold a community together that is at risk of tearing apart. His words and actions call for unity, grounded in love across differences. In the gospel today, Jesus meets with resistance in Samaria. It doesn't seem to faze him, as he is focused on the bigger picture, his fulfillment of the work God has given him. On the other hand, his disciples are angry and ready to wreak vengeance on those who oppose him. The text says Jesus rebukes them. They have misunderstood what power really entails. The power of love is transformative, not coercive. Freedom. We talk about that a lot in our country. The foundational story we tell of ourselves is about liberation from the power of the British government. But that is the story from only one perspective. The histories of the indigenous and enslaved in this country are quite different. All of the histories need to be heard in order for the truth to be understood. We are a divided nation, divided on so many levels. Divided about so many issues. We value our own freedom while wishing to deny freedom to each other. We all believe we hold the truth, but we hold only pieces. For freedom, Christ has set us free. That freedom was bought with a price, Christ's offering of his life. And as was true of the Galatian community, so we too are all bound together by that sacrifice of love. There may be disagreement and division, but like it or not, we are connected through the God of love. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. So how do you love your neighbor when they stand for everything you are against and against everything you stand for? Perhaps a first step is getting to know each other. Perhaps a first step is listening to each other. Perhaps a first step is treating each other with respect. It is so easy to move from righteous anger to hatred and violence not only of action, but of speech. It is not so easy once we get to know someone, once we understand their perspective. We may disagree, but understanding keeps us connected. During her time as rector of St. John's in Jamaica Plain, the Reverend Ann Fowler participated in the Community Conversations Project, a local initiative to bring people together across differences, to listen and understand each other. For 25 years, she met with groups of women on both sides of the abortion issue. They met and talked and got to know each other as human beings. The purpose of their dialogue was not to convince each other to change their minds, but to come to an understanding of who each person was. God calls us to justice, but there are divergent opinions on what exactly justice looks like. People are trying to convince each other without understanding each other. I fear that endeavor is doomed to failure. We must put aside our differences and treat each other as the beloved children of God we all are. We must listen to each other's stories without trying to convince or manipulate. Only when we have true understanding will we be fully understanding of God's will for us and for all people. Amen. Our service now continues with the Apostles' Creed, which is found in your worship book on page 4. Please rise as you are able for the Apostles' Creed on page 4. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The suffrages. Help us, O God, our Savior.
Deliver us and forgive us our sins.
Look upon your congregation.
Give to your people the blessing of peace.
Declare your glory among the nations.
And your wonders among all peoples.
Do not let the oppressed be shamed and turned away.
Never forget the lives of your poor.
Continue your loving kindness to those who know you.
And your favor to those who are true of heart.
Satisfy us by your loving kindness in the morning.
So shall we rejoice and be glad all the days of our life.
Today's collect. Almighty God, who has built thy church upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, grant us so to be joined together in unity of spirit by their doctrine, that we may be made an holy temple acceptable unto thee. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
O God, you make us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son. Give us a day such blessings through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor, through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
Amen.
The prayers of the people will be read by Hazel Brasino.
Prayers of the people, form 2. I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for our bishops, Alan and Gail, and for Carol and Bud, for this gathering, and for all ministers and people. We pray for our sister black churches, St. Bartholomew's, Church of the Holy Spirit, St. Cyprian's, St. John, St. James, St. Mark's, and St. Mary's. In the Diocesan Cycle of Prayer, Member Grace Church, New Bedford, St. Andrew's Church, New Bedford, St. Martin's Church, New Bedford, Society for the Relief of Widows, Widowers, and Orphans of the Episcopal Church Clergy, and Society for the Relief of Aged or Disabled Episcopal Clergy. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace.
We pray especially for those in Ukraine. We pray for our own country in its time of division.
I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Pray for those who are in any need in trouble. I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of God. Pray that they may find and be found by God. I ask your prayers for the departed. Pray for those who have died. I ask your prayers for those on our prayer list and those you pray for aloud or in silence. I ask your prayers for Thanksgiving. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day.
Of your people, and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ, our Savior. At this time, we recognize those who are celebrating birthdays. I see there are two people on our list. One of them is Evan Bryant, and the other one is Catherine Fleming. So let us say the birthday prayer for Evan and for Catherine. O God, our time's in your hands. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace, and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives, through our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We pray for those who are traveling, particularly Kafi. O God, our heavenly Creator, whose glory fills the whole creation and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, surround them with your loving care, protect them from every danger, and bring them in safety to their journey's end through Jesus Christ, our Sovereign. Amen. Did Evan want to come up and get us to sing Happy Birthday? Sounds like a plan to me. How old are you, Evan? Evan turned 13. This is a big deal, folks. It's a big deal. He is now a teenager. All right, let's sing Happy Birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Evan. Happy birthday to you. Yay. Turn around, Evan, so they can see you. All right, 13.
Happy birthday, Evan.
All right. Now we pray for those in the law enforcement and the military. Almighty God, we commend to your gracious care and keeping the men and women summoned to serve and protect us in times of conflict. Defend them day by day with your heavenly grace. Strengthen them in their trials and temptations. Give them courage to face the perils which beset them, and grant them a sense of your abiding presence wherever they may be. Uphold, guide, and protect them. Make them wise in the exercise of their authority. Correct them in any error. Protect them from danger, and make them instruments of peace. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you. You are welcome to exchange the peace here, and if you're online, to unmute yourselves and to exchange the peace.
Peace of the Lord be with you, everyone.
Peace of the Lord be with everyone.
Peace of the Lord, everyone.
Good morning, church family. As you know, Evan will be leaving our church to be closer to his sister in Alabama. His last days with us will be Sunday, July 31st. On Sunday, July 17th, we will celebrate our 17 years of ministry together with a special collation for after the service. Let me repeat that part. A special collation after the service. That means I'm looking for you to participate financially or with a cooked dish. To honor him as opposed to giving him gifts and per his request, we have created the Father Evan Thayer Fund. And now we'll be asking for cash donations and which we will present to him. You know, like you see the large checks on our TV? We want to present a large check to him, and he in return will represent, give that check back to the church. So actually you're donating to the church through him, and this is what he wants to do because he loves us so dearly. Okay? And that's the truth. That was my ad lib. Okay, where did I leave off? All contributions will go to our church, so please come out and spend these last six Sundays with our rector. Definitely come to church on July 17th and July 31st, and we welcome you to make a contribution to this fund in his honor. Okay, so I'm really asking people to really dig deep and do the best you can to make it a very nice donation because it is coming right back to you. And I'll be speaking to you personally about a food donation or a financial donation for the coalition. Okay, thank you so much. Thank you, Reverend Thayer.
Thank you, Mr. You've been told, okay? Just a couple more things. Know that the Reverend John Clark has agreed to be the bridge priest for this congregation after my departure. He will be here on my last Sunday. And he will be here in the office earlier than that, just getting a sense of things. And then he will keep office hours here once a week, I believe. And so please, if you haven't met him before, John was a seminarian here back in the bad old days and loves this congregation very much. And I'm sure that when you meet him again, you will remember him with fondness. So you will be in good hands. And now, ascribe to the Lord the honor to his name, bring offerings, and come into God's courts.
Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. Over me and before I'll be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free. Oh, freedom.
Go home to my Lord and be free.
Of hope for our journey, and so as the morning stars sing your praises, we join the heavenly beings and all creation as we shout with joy, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Glory and honor are yours, Creator of all. Your word has never been silent. You call a people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace, you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign and give himself for us a fragrant offering. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died for us, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his friends, and said, Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends and said, Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection and ascension, longing for Christ coming in glory, and presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Christ Jesus, come in glory. Send your spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and in the fullness of time gather us with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed Augustine, Blessed Martin, and all your people, into the joy of our true eternal home. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise. Blessed are you, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Let us pray with those who are worshiping online. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though you have already come, I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Yeah.
Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. The wisdom of God, the love of God, and the grace of God strengthen you to be Christ's hands and heart in this world. In the name of the Holy Trinity.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.